Hello, welcome back to the We Dive Deeper podcast, series two, friends. Can I get a hell fucking yes? My name is Kate McGill, and this is the podcast where small talk goes to die. It's where my guests pick at random from 70 of my all-time favorite questions, each one as personal and intrusive as the last. I am so stupidly happy to be back doing this, being back in your ears. Feels so good. Thanks for letting me be there. So I'm going to be trying something a little bit different this series. As some of you may know, I am on a site called Patreon, patreon.com/KateMcGill for all those out there who want to go and have a look at my page. And it's a site where people can support their favorite creators and everything that they do. So for series two, I have been training it around the UK, staying in different Airbnbs to talk to some of my upcoming guests. And whilst it has been so fun and so amazing, it's also been expensive. Let's call a spade, folks. So with that in mind, I will be offering the last 10-15 minutes of every single episode exclusively to my patrons. Not only will you get the episodes earlier, but you'll now get the fully fledged episodes for as little as $1 a month. And if you don't have the money or you just don't feel like it, that is totally fine. I appreciate you just the same. But for those of you who do want to support me in the podcast, you can do at patreon.com/KateMcGill. It will massively help me. It will help me live and it will help me produce further episodes and content for you, and I'd be forever in your debt. Okay, with that out of the way, let's move on to episode one. My guest today is Sarah Goodhart. She was on the 14th series of Geordie Shore, and she was on X on the Beach. And it's actually quite funny how we came into contact. She uploaded a video detailing everything behind her experience with Geordie Shore and how traumatic it was for her and how little it seemed that they cared about the people within the show. And I thought it was so brave and amazing, and she came across so well and so differently to how she was kind of edited to come across in Geordie Shore. So I tweeted her and I sent her some love and some admiration, and she replied saying, "Hey, I used to watch your YouTube videos." So I was like, this is mental. So I thought, given that Love Island has ended now and we all need a bit of a reality TV fix because I love it just as much as the next guy, it would be really cool to chat to her. So I got a flight over to Newcastle and spent the night with her. Wait, that sounds weird. We didn't spend the night together, but she did take me out for a chicken Kiev pizza. And it was such an awesome night. It was so awesome to get to know her. And this chat is probably one of my favorites so far. So without further ado, I really hope you enjoy. Thanks for listening. And here is my chat with Sarah Goodhart. So today I'm in Newcastle. I've made the journey on a hangover to come and see Sarah Goodhart, who I don't know how I stumbled across you, actually, because I hadn't seen you in Geordie Shore.
Yeah.
But I'd heard about your YouTube video first. Mm-hmm. So I watched that and just thought, this girl's amazing. I tweeted you. You tweeted back. We're like, oh, wow. Like, I used to watch your videos. I was like, what the fuck? And then I went back and watched Geordie Shore. And it was after hearing everything you'd said, I was like, fuck me. This girl really, really went through it.
Oh, my God. I didn't realize that you actually went and watched Geordie Shore after seeing the video.
Yeah.
Oh, bless you. That is so canny.
And you were on, I never saw X on the Beach. You were on that too?
Oh my God. Yeah. You don't want to watch that.
Which one did you do first?
I did X on the Beach first. I was literally a baby. I must have been like, maybe I was like 19, 20 when I did that. Like,
fuck. Yeah. How did they cast you for that?
So they DM'd me on Twitter, and they DM'd my boyfriend at the time, which was actually really weird because we actually weren't exes.
Oh, weird.
So the strange situation.
That's
Martin, yeah,
right.
And then like we were both meeting up with the producers, like trying to sort it out, and then like I just one day went to him, I was like, are you talking to X on the Beach? And he was like, yeah. And I was like, so what we're gonna do about the search? And he was like, well, why don't we just go and like pretend that we're exes, and then we'll just like reunite there.
Oh, so it's like so fucking fake.
Yeah. And then we actually like did actually break up like 3 days before he flew out.
Whoa.
So that's why, like, when I went out, I was crazy, like, next level, like, so sad about the sitch when I got there. And then everyone, when it actually came out and people were tweeting about it, they were like, oh my god, why is this crazy girl going on like this? It's as if they're still together. I'm like, yeah, we literally were like just a hot minute before we came out here. And then obviously I had to get there, and then he'd already been like getting with people and stuff. So that one was pretty rad, but it was nowhere near as like traumatic as Geordie Shore, because he actually ended up getting kicked off like a few days after because he was so dehydrated. He just doesn't eat like good food. He just want like chicken nuggets and shit, and he would never drink water. And obviously we're in Mexico.
Shit.
So it got shipped away. So I just had like a holiday after that. Like I was just chilling. So that one wasn't so bad.
And how long did that process last, the X on the beach bit?
I think we filmed it in like 3 weeks.
Oh, okay, so like super quick.
Yeah.
And Geordie Shore was how long over like the whole?
So Geordie Shore was filmed in 2 parts, and we thought that it was like 2 different seasons. Like we didn't realize that it was one big season being filmed over 1 part, because like I said, like, they were really deceitful.
Yeah, so we have to get into this whole fucking story. Oh, gosh. For people that don't know,
it's a rabbit hole.
Yeah,
MTV, you're gonna put a bullet in my brain. If anything happens to us, you know why.
Well, if you're listening, MTV, hello, welcome to the weed.
Oh,
no, but if you haven't watched Sarah's YouTube video, go and watch it. It's called The Truth, Sarah Goodhart, and you go into like pretty, like a lot of detail about like the hell that you went through.
Mm-hmm.
So talk us through it from like day one. Obviously, I'm guessing they found out about you then from X on the Beach.
Yeah.
That's where you were on their radar.
Yeah, so it's like the same team of like producers and casting people and stuff. I think, to be honest, I always liked Martin more because he was like super charismatic. Like he's made for television, do you know what I mean? Like he can handle it, he loves it, like loves the drama, etc. But yeah, they basically like approached me for that. And then like what annoyed us so much about that, and what people I think sometimes don't grasp, because I get a lot of like the diehard like fans and stuff being like, you're a liar, this isn't true, like look at like all the other people who are on all different shows. And I'm like, the thing is, the difference between say Geordie Shore and like Towie or Made in Chelsea is they film, they go home, they have their phone, they have a bath, they can speak to their family, they can do whatever, and then they go back. Whereas Geordie Shore is more, you're there, you're not allowed your phone, you're not allowed any contact with anyone from the outside world. You get drunk every night and then you start filming at 8 a.m. So like they want you to be ratty kind of thing.
Right.
But what the thing that, like, that's all good and well, but the thing that I think put me in such a stressful position was that they told me that I was just going to be like a permanent cast member. And so like I was like, all right, cool, like left my job, like left a lot of things behind.
Jesus.
For it. Which they don't realise, I just say it's like a number, like statistic kind of thing. And then when I obviously get there, and they don't actually reveal to you that it's a process of elimination until midway through like filming like a weekend or something. And then I was like, well, now they've put me in such a compromising position because I can't be myself and I can't be this like fun, bubbly character that I would love to be for them, because that's what they cast me for. Because I'm like obviously had anxiety, depression, etc. I was like, this is like such an awful position to be in. I don't want to be competing against other people. Like I don't want to be in this high pressure environment whereby the older cast members, like they literally had a bell that they could ring and like we'd have to run and get them. It was so fucking degrading.
Are you actually joking? They
no,
had
I
a
swear
bell
to, if you watch it back, like knowing that, you would be like, this is actually really degrading. Like, I'm not like a young girl. I was like a friggin' like, maybe how old would I be, like 24, like a 24 year old woman. Like I don't want to be treated like that.
Yeah. Wait, so the older cast member, or the more like original ones,
yeah,
they would ring a bell for you to get them.
Yeah,
things.
So we had to basically be doing these tasks to like impress them. But obviously it had absolutely sod all to do with who they picked, by the way. The producers picked, and
right,
then would just like whisper in their ears like, you've got to say this person. But yeah, it was just a really like dehumanizing, and I know like it's Geordie Shore, like it's not the friggin' Apprentice. I'm not there to be like all serious and like chill out and do meditation every day. But you still have to be treated like a normal person. And then that's what annoyed us, because like I say, we filmed it in 2 parts. So like after part one, like we were obviously like, oh well, we must have like made it through to like the final cast or whatever. And then we get to part two, which is skiing, literally like just about to go skiing, and then they're like, oh yeah, this actually isn't over, like we're doing that process again. And then I was like, oh for fuck's sake.
And I guess, like, do you reckon they almost delayed telling you that so that you would
be
100%,
I wouldn't have turned up to part two if I'd known it was that, and I don't think any of us would.
Jesus.
And so we were literally trapped. Can you imagine?
Yeah.
Didn't have my phone, not able to contact someone. Like, and the producers kind of like, I mean, not all of them, like, I don't want to like badmouth them all because some of them were really nice people, but the best producers were the ones who were completely heartless because they could like get the tea, do you know what I mean? But they kind of like brainwashed you into the fact of when this first happened, I was like, look, I have put a lot on the line for this. Like, I don't really want this to be the situation. I feel like you've really like had the wool over my eyes to get me here and I don't appreciate it kind of thing. And they're like, yeah, but now you are here. Do you want to ruin this situation for yourself or do you want to take the chance? And I was like, yeah, like at that time I was like, yeah, good point. Like I've done the whole process. Like I might as well see it
if
I make
end.
It to the end. But then I think if I had actually been made permanent, I would not have lasted. Do you know what I mean?
Really? How long do you think you would have carried it on?
I don't even know if I would have done the season after, to be honest. But yeah, I think at that time in my life, like I touched on in the video, like I just felt really vulnerable. Like I didn't really know where my life was going. I just knew I wanted, like, I want to be rich. I still want to be rich. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I would have done anything to have got money at that point. I think that's what like made me think, yeah, I'm going to put my all into it. And when I was a bit younger, I kind of wanted like that sort of like the fame and like all that. Like it appealed to me. Like I wanted to be like a somebody kind of thing. I talk about this with my therapist and she's like, it's called perfectionisms, whereby like, I think I felt like I always had to prove people wrong and that I wanted to be like this huge like character, whether that was fame or whatever. I wanted it.
Right.
I didn't know what it was. And then when I had a taste of it, I was like, yeah, fuck that. I don't want that.
Wow. So do you think Geordie Shore like exacerbated all of your like mental health kind of problems?
Oh my God,
like,
yes.
Because like, you suffered from like anxiety and depression anyway, right?
Yeah.
And that, I mean, that was, I guess, like a breeding ground for that.
Yeah.
Like,
it's just like for people to say that it's not a toxic environment, like what they want is obviously the argument. Like they want like romances to blossom, like they want people to like sleep together, like they want you to be like at each other's throats. I'm sorry, but like if anyone says that's not the concept, they're a liar, because it is.
Yeah, it is.
And obviously, like I say, like I just felt trapped. Like I don't know where these, like this, always speak of like therapists on site. Like I asked to see several times, never got the chance because the schedule was so tight. Like I don't know, like it's such a hard thing because unless you've been through it, it's so hard to describe, because people be like, oh, you complain about nothing. But like when I say my day job that I had at the time was so much easier than what I did, I would have much rather just been at work. Like, do you know what I mean?
And so they, when you asked for help, they didn't give you it?
No, because there was several times, like I say in the video, like asked for medication, didn't get that. Like, because it's a long line, like before it gets to the top, you have to go through like a runner and then like a producer and such, so on and so forth. Take days to get anything done, and they openly admitted that schedule was very tight because there was so many new cast members.
Oh my God.
And so on your down days, which is meant to be where you're relaxing, you would just have to do green screen all day. So
it's not a down day at all?
Nah, not at all.
So what was the schedule like?
I think it was you film for 3 or 4 days and then you're meant to get your down day, and on that down day you get a request. So on that request you could either have a phone call home or you could like be taken to the shops or something, but like they would literally like they'd follow you everywhere, so you couldn't be like, oh, give us a look at your phone or like go and slyly text your mate or anything like that.
That is like, that feels very, yeah, this is weird. What I think, cultish almost.
Oh my God, you've got no idea. Like people don't realize like Geordie Shore's very different to the other reality shows, I think in that sense.
It.
But I think it's one of them things, like how long's reality TV been out? Like not that much longer than a decade, maybe like Paris Hilton like made it big, do you know what I mean? I think it's one of them things where not enough people have experienced it, because it's such a niche amount of people who actually know what it's like to know the long-term effects of it. Obviously now we are seeing that because there is people taking their own lives.
And you fucking predicted that.
I predicted it. I put that video out because I said this is going to push someone too far, two people later. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that's getting proven. I honestly think in maybe another 10 years time it might actually be banned, because
it is like, and this is where the kind of my own morals come into question here, because mm-hmm. it's so entertaining. Mm-hmm. Like you're watching Love Island.
Yeah, this is what I mean. Like I think people have this perception that I'm like oh, like, fuck reality television, like, it shouldn't be around, like, this, that, and the other. And I think, no, you can watch it responsibly. And I think that's what we're kind of, I think there's a responsibility as a viewer and there's a responsibility as a producer. And I think they both need to be met better. So, for instance, last year, I was watching Love Island, and I would tweet about Love Island, I would hashtag Love Island, and I would say stuff. I would never, ever comment on, like their appearance or anything, or because I know how things are edited, I would only ever comment on things that had came from their mouth, not in, like, a green screen situation. So, like, their behaviour, do you know what I mean? Which is fair. Never in, like, a negative way, like, just, like, funny stuff in a constructive way. And then those tweets would always get picked up by the press, like, they would go viral, like, it was really good for engagement. But this year, I was like, I'm still going to watch Love Island, but I'm not going to promote it. I'm not going to really talk about it. Like, I'm just going to watch it, see how it unfolds. But I don't really want to feed into it.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, because I really struggle to understand when people are just mean for the sake of mean.
Like, yeah.
And they'll jump on, and because you said, it's like it's so heavily edited, they can make you look a certain way. That feels like it's obvious, but people jump on that bandwagon, and like people hated Joe because they thought he was controlling.
Oh my God.
And then like a week later, they're all like, oh no, he's fine now. But like people go in on these people.
And this is kind of the point I'm trying to make, is that I'm not saying like reality television shouldn't be there. What it should be is, I think it should be more like constructively thought about, and it should have a touch more of like a positive resolution at the end of it. Do you know what I mean? It should just be a bit more of a positive vibe. Like, I love the episodes where they're really getting on and like they're having fun and shit. Like, I actually do love to see that, or when the outcome you want happens, like Tommy and Molly May, for instance. Like,
yeah,
I love that. And I think, I don't know why producers haven't grasped it. We like to see that much as we like to see that stuff as much as like all the shitty stuff.
Yeah.
And I think we also need to realize that the target audience for these is young people, and we do need to think, like, these are our most watched television shows. How are they influencing the younger generation? Because at the minute they're kind of just screaming, we need to literally physically compete in the instance of Love Island for the attention of the opposite sex.
Yeah, that's kind of weird when you put it like that.
Yeah, because that's what it is. So I think we just all need to progress. We need to progress as viewers. We need to be more sensitive and realize these are people's sons, daughters, etc. And I think producers need to start thinking, maybe we need to be a bit less brutal, and we do need the aftercare in place, and we need to be clear with these people about what's going to happen after, etc. Because like, people are always just like, oh, like, you sign up for it. Like, I feel like if you go under the comments on my YouTube video, there's a lot of victim blaming in it. And I'm not saying that, like, I'm not at fault at all. Like, I know what Geordie Shore is. Like, I'm not stupid. But I don't think I deserve to be treated how I was treated. And I don't think I deserved to be in such a bad place mentally after, as a result. And this is why I say I do think in years to come, we'll realise more as a society how heavily it affects the cast, and it just affects, like, I mean, everyone who comes out of Love Island, for instance, becomes an influencer. And so we just
like straight away their job is that, essentially.
So we just need to be thinking, like, this is such a huge thing, it's whirlwind, and because of Instagram, how can we sort of make sure it doesn't go too far? And I mean, in a way it already has, so we kind of need to rein it back in.
Yeah, because they, like you said on the video, you do a psych test, right? But it's all bullshit because everyone lies.
Yeah. Like, you do the psych test.
And what does that consist of? Like, what is it?
So, for instance, they'll ask you, they ask you stuff about your childhood, and, like, they get
they
deep.
Do a wee dive deeper.
Yeah, they do a wee dive deeper, basically. But they'll be, like, the yes or no questions. So, have you ever struggled with mental health? Have you ever had a criminal conviction? Like, have you ever physically harmed someone? Like, that sort of stuff.
Okay.
If you want to be in this show, you're not going to sit there and go, got, like, loads of mental disorders. Like, beat someone up once, got arrested. Like, you're just not going to do it.
So it's just kind of a known thing.
And they mustn't research it after. Because if they did, then half of the people that were there would not be there.
So that just makes no... They're doing it for
insurance purposes.
Their backs,
yeah. 100%.
And the aftermath, obviously, the lowest bit for you was the skiing bit, right?
Yeah.
Talk us through that for people who haven't seen your video, if you want to.
Yeah, so obviously when we got to skiing, I realised it was, again, like, process of elimination kind of vibe. First off, like, we never actually got taught how to ski. We did one skiing lesson, but it was filmed. So, like, it wasn't an actual skiing lesson. It was just like, oh, go down the hill with this guy and, like, look happy about it kind of thing. So when everyone else is doing the skiing, I couldn't physically participate because I'd never been before. Like, I could do the smallest hill, but, like, I had no idea what I was doing. And, like, that's when I started, like, having my panic attacks and stuff. And then I have, like, anemia as well. So, like, I need to take, like, an iron tablet, which, like, if you have anemia, like, you, like, have, like, chronic exhaustion, like, your muscles ache, like, you're super tired and you're really irritable.
Like, and you're, like, on no sleep anyway, yeah, right?
Yeah, exactly. So drinking, like, really little amount of sleep. Like, no one was getting us new tablets. Everyone was just ignoring us because I think I wasn't one of, like, the feisty ones. Like, I would be really polite to people. And unless you're literally an absolute dick to them, which, like, some people were, you're not going to get what you want. And I just think there's so many things that just slipped through the net. And, like, I don't want to blame one person. It was, like, the whole team as a whole. Like, there was just little bits that they kept missing that I was like, that's actually quite dangerous. And I think, hopefully, like, they'll work on that, and that I hope that they don't listen to the things that I say and think, God, Sarah's such a dick, or she's such a liar, because it's just, it's not the
well,
case.
Given everything that's yeah. gone on, like, it's not like you're the only fucking person saying this. This is clearly yeah. a thing that is happening,
and it's alarming how many people have messaged me after that video and were like, they're on, like, big shows, and they're like, yeah, I completely agree with everything you said. I wish I could show public support, but I can't because of either contracts or, you know, I'm in this industry now. Like, I need more work and stuff like that.
Bloody hell.
That's what, when you're saying it's a cult before, like, it really is.
Yeah, it feels like you're not allowed to speak to your family and friends when you're there, but also you're just made to be quiet after. Not. That's just fucked.
I know, and I often think, like, I don't know how I got away with what I did, but I suppose it would look so much worse if I released that video and then they're like, yeah, we're suing Sarah Goodhart.
Yeah, what was the reaction?
What, from their part?
From, like, peers on the show, or, like, the people in the team, or friends, family.
Do you know what? It's amazing because everyone from the show I'm still friends with, everyone was so supportive, because they know that, like, what I'm saying is true, but they just know that they're a bit mentally stronger, like, they're a bit wiser to it. So, and they also weren't in a situation like we were. Like, what was happening to us, they were like, that's not fair. Like, Sophie at one point physically cried, and she was like, what you're doing to these people isn't right. Do you know what I mean? Obviously, you'd never show that. But yeah, everyone's been so supportive, like, still friends with all of them. And I think they could just see how bad I was when I was there. It's like, I used to, like, cry all the time. And at the start, it was kind of like a bit of a joke within the show. Like, everyone was like, oh, Sarah's got the waterworks on again. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
It's just because I just found it, like, such a, I don't know, I'm the sort of person, I need to stop, I need to recharge, like, I need to not be around people. And when you're in a house of, like, so many people, and, like, you don't get 2 minutes yourself, like, even, like, on, if you're in a club, like, if you go to the toilet, like, they'll follow you in the toilet, do you know what I mean? So,
fucking hell.
It's very, very intense.
So was there any, like, aftermath care?
They tried to reach out to me through my agent.
Because of the video. Oh, fucking hell. Bit late for that.
Yeah, but I was so scared. I was like, just tell them to delete my number. Like, I don't want to ever speak to them.
Wow.
But yeah.
Does that stuff and that period of your life, like, still affect you today?
Heavily.
Really?
In Talk about it in therapy all the time. Like, you don't realise.
Sorry about that, guys.
Let's
just carrying on.
Yeah, you don't realise, like, how much, like,
how does it manifest?
Well, for a long while, like, I was actually, like, unemployed after. I was doing, like, I think the first few months, because I was on the telly, like, the Instagram posts were enough to get by on. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. And then after that, like, I was too embarrassed and I was too anxious to, like, return to, especially my previous job, which I absolutely loved.
Sucks.
I just wouldn't have went back after that. And then, yeah, I was literally on, like, job seekers because I was like, I didn't want to work, but, like, I had to, like, just do what I could and, like, sort myself out. And I literally just became this, like, depressed mess who would just lie in bed all day. Like, yeah, it was quite sad. I think my parents were quite alarmed by how it was after. And it wouldn't have been like that if I hadn't have done it. But then at the same time, like, people ask us, do you regret it? and I still say no, because right. I'm like, I feel like I had to go through it. Like,
yeah, like we were saying before the podcast started, like we both feel like we've gone through so many lows now,
mm-hmm.
that the only way is actually up. Well, that's how it feels. You're like, well, you kind of have to choose to be happy, because there is so much stuff yeah. that can bring you down every fucking day.
Oh my god, you're not wrong there.
Wow. So I wanted to ask something else about Geordie Shore. We can cut this bit out. make a mental note of where I am. 683. I wrote down some. I have so much I still want to ask you. Okay, so being an insider, how fake and scripted are these shows?
Right, so when you say it's scripted, you don't have a physical script in front of you saying Sarah, and then like, well, actually, sometimes you do. So there's two different parts. Obviously, there's like the main part where someone will have a sheet in front of them, some sort of producer, and it'll say like the theme of what the scene is, and they'll be like, make sure you ask Zahida this, or make sure you ask Sarah that. Like, they'll have the questions written out and they'll say to you, you ask this person this now. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's, okay. it's not always natural and comes from you. Whereas in green screen, there is physically someone from London, like in an office, writing your lines. And like,
yeah, because
some of them are natural, some of them are organic that you come out with, because they'll ask you questions, but they'll have ones and they'll say, we need this for the edit, and it'll be like lines, and then there'll be ones where you're like, I'm not saying it, and they're like, you have to say it otherwise. Like,
yeah, what was the one that you had to say? Yes. You were like, what the
literally
fuck?
Something about Martin having like a donkey dick or something, I don't know, it was horrendous anyways, but I just couldn't believe I was literally sat there like, I ain't saying it, and like everyone in the room just had their head down, because they were like, this is so wildly inappropriate, you can't force someone to say that, and like,
but they did.
With me was like, you need to say this, otherwise like your shift isn't finished, like I need this to be said. So I just said it because I was like, right, fucking go, yeah.
Like I just need to get out. Yeah,
but there's so many different instances of that, it's not just that. And then yeah, it's
so it's pretty,
to say it's scripted is true. Yeah.
Wow. And what about like storylines and stuff, like do they, before filming the show, they have kind of a clear idea of where they want to end the show?
I think so. I think they're clever enough to know how things will pan out. Like, they obviously know they're going to put me in there. That's going to piss Chloe off because I'm Martin's ex-girlfriend. She's, like, madly in love with him at the time. They know there's going to be a controversy there. I feel like they just know all the routes that'll happen because they're experts. That's why they're in the right. job. Do you know what I mean?
And do you reckon they have kind of, like, psychologists and stuff there to be like, okay, what do we think this person's going to react in this way? How?
Yeah.
Like,
I think so. So I used to speculate about it all the time, and I'd be like, I don't know, I just feel like they know how to veer you in the direction of doing it. Like, they would tell you false things about the other person, but like, oh well, this person said this about you, to make you have an argument with them. Like, this is how brutal it is.
Well, like, they tell you that like off screen.
Yeah, off the off camera stuff is the bad stuff.
Really?
Yeah.
Let's pull that tiny bit closer to you.
Oh.
Or like move this little bit. There we go.
Okay.
Where are we? I'll make another mental note.
I do this all the time, by the way, don't worry, it's not you specifically.
Okay. Yeah, so what's the off camera stuff? Can you remember like specific things that were just like, what is actually happening?
Obviously the one and the feud between me and Zahida. And
you were friends, right?
We were like, best friends before that show. Like, we're good friends again now, thank God.
Oh, thank God.
But
that was because it was pretty broken for a while, right? I remember you saying at the end of your video, like, it hasn't really been the same since.
Yeah.
But it's good now.
Yeah.
Thank God.
But, like, they would, like, say stuff to both me and her. But, oh, well, she said this, you know, or, like, she did this. Or they'd imply things. Like, when you're doing your green screen and they'd ask you a question. And I'd be like, well, I know you've asked her that same question, so what's her response? They can't tell you. But they'd be like, oh, well, I mean, do you know what I mean? Like, they're trying to just, like, veer it to what would make the good
fucking
final cut.
Hell.
It's brutal. It people really have is. No idea. Like, I couldn't believe. There was an article that came out recently about how on Love Island's down day, they go to the beach. And people were so shook by it. They were like, oh, my God, can't believe this. Like, this ruins the whole show. And I was like, you just have no idea what goes on. Like, people, I think people just think that these chats just happen naturally. You know, whenever there's, like, a main scene, there'll be a full-on camera crew of about 15 people around them with a camera on their face at that moment. Like, it's not all done on the little eyelet cams. So, like...
Yeah, that makes sense, actually.
Yeah. So, like, you, people think that it's just so natural and it just flows and it's just so not true. There'll be someone going, so, Molly, you ask such and such this now. Do you know what I mean? That's how mad, like, it is.
Fucking hell. Like, I definitely... I think when I first started watching reality TV, like Made in Chelsea and Towie and stuff,
yeah,
because I just fucking love it.
Yeah.
But I definitely convinced myself that it was like really real, or as real as it could be.
Yeah.
But it does just make so much sense, especially when like stuff like Love Island is such, the quality is always so good all the time. There's no way that normal life would just carry on like that. Do you know what I mean? It must be so kind of manufactured. But it's just, it's crazy when you think of how manufactured it is. And then these people have to be okay with the fact that they may be portrayed in a certain way. Like, yeah. I'm guessing when you came out of Geordie Shore, people had like made up their mind about you.
Oh my God, yeah. And that was part of the reason why I did the video. Because at the time I was just like, right, like, I was just sad and I was just like, I'll just like take the hit, like people think I'm this like villain or like this like stupid like girl, whatever. And then I was like, you know what, I'm not gonna let these people take my identity of who I really am. I was like, because I know who I really am. I didn't even have the chance to really portray properly who I really was when I was there, because it was just such a horrible environment and nobody would like listen to us, whatever. But I was just like, yeah, I'm not gonna just lie down and take it anymore. Like, I'm gonna stand up for myself. And it's good, because I feel like people who follow me and stuff now are like such authentic followers. Like, they're like so nice to us, get lush messages every day, and I'm like, I'm so glad I did that, because if I didn't, they would have just thought that I was that.
Yeah. Do you think that video was kind of a turning point for you then?
1,000,000%. And I was so scared when I put it out. I literally uploaded it, like slammed my laptop shut and just like put it away for like an hour, and like I thought maybe a few people would see it. Like, I didn't think it would go,
yeah, because it went off pretty viral, right?
Well, yeah, the next day I woke up and it was on like the Snapchat stories, and the press wanted to speak to us, and like MTV had like apparently like my agent was like, yeah, I've had everyone on the phone today, like this has caused quite the corruption. But like, we loved it though, because we were like, yeah, well, that's good, like it's had an effect. And I really do think it made people think. Like, I've had people saying like, I'm still watching reality TV, but I'm watching it in a totally different light.
Yeah. I am with them. Like, yeah. I definitely saw reality TV differently after I watched your video.
Yeah.
For sure. And how cool that you have been the person who's been in it and is speaking the truth. Like, how cool. No one else is fucking doing that.
I know.
You're amazing.
I think everyone was just so scared and tied in a contract, but because they'd already fucked me over, I was like, well, I already know I'm not going to do this again. So like, let's do it. Let's have it. Do you know what I mean?
Bloody hell.
And then I think the best thing was when people who had worked on that series with me messaged me and said, you know what, you were right. Like, I saw that happen and it made me so uncomfortable to see this go on like a professional environment. I'll make sure I never make another cast member feel like that. Like, that was when I was like, yeah, I did right.
Well, wait, so producers and people that were in the teams have been
people
like,
people who
realized
were involved in it have messaged me privately and being like, you were right, like that was really wrong and we won't let it happen again.
So you could quite literally have changed the course of, definitely even in Geordie Shore, they've been like, okay, we know how bad it can get, we make sure
I
we
hope
won't.
So
that's so fucking cool, Sarah. Yeah. That's amazing. What a whirlwind though, right? You'd like, fucking hell, who would have thought that just signing up to like a little thing and then ending it, like, whoa, what just happened? Because I'm guessing that's a huge event in your life that's probably shaped you as a human being entirely.
It's so strange because I was so 50-50 on doing it. I am so glad that I did. I mean, ask us again if like I get thrown in prison in like 5 years without enough evidence, be like, fuck you, fellas.
So I'm guessing you would never in 1,000,000 years do TV again.
Right. So the only one thing I would do again, if I got the chance, again, like I've done it, I haven't done it, Strictly Come Dancing, I would fuck with heavily.
Wow.
I'd love to do Strictly.
Wait, because you're like doing dancing at the moment, right? You're doing like pole dancing?
I don't know where you got the pole dancing from.
Is it pole dancing?
It's quite like, some of it's quite sexy. It varies week to week.
I want to do it.
Oh my God. Oh, if you were here on Tuesday, you could have done it. There'll be one on Tuesday night.
I like love dancing. Yeah. It doesn't mean I'm good at it, but I fucking
love it. No, I'm really literally quite terrible at it, which is like such an ironic thing, because for a long time I worked like in Newcastle, like as, and I'm doing quotation marks with my fingers, a dancer, like a hostess would call them in Newcastle. You don't actually have to have any technical dance skills, but you just wear underwear and like walk around the club and like shimmy a bit. I literally slipped under the radar for like 7 years as someone who on the surface could dance, but I'm actually really, really bad.
I don't know. I've seen videos of you.
Well, I mean, it's thanks to Kirsty's training. Kirsty, if you're listening, you're amazing. But I would want to do Strictly. I'd probably be like the joke act, like, you know, like the GC. Like, I'd probably yeah. like be out in week three. But I mean, Stacey Dooley, she wasn't a professional and she won it. So
very true. Do you still have like an agent then for any of that kind of stuff?
I do, yeah. I've had the same agent since I first came out. And it's good because like, they could have went badly with that because they obviously have a really good relationship with MTV because they have Geordie Shore cast members on the agency. And like, my agent was actually like really supportive and he was like, I think it's really good what you're doing with YouTube, like we'll roll with this vibe kind of thing.
Amazing.
Whereas it could have been like, yeah, like stop doing that.
Yeah.
But no.
So how do you, because like, I mean, sorry to keep going back to Geordie Shore, it's just such a fucking anomaly in someone's life. It's crazy. Like how, the people that are in it now, how the fuck do they do it? Because it feels, mm-hmm. like you said, so different to any other reality TV.
Yeah.
It's so intense and you are just getting drunk all the time.
Yeah.
The hangovers, the probably mm-hmm. the inevitable depression of just being alcohol.
Yeah.
And then just constant filming. And I'm guessing the money makes it easier for them. But like,
yeah,
it takes a certain type of human being to do that, right?
Yeah, I would agree. I think... first of all, us Geordies are a very different breed. Like, I think for a lot of people who are actually in it, it's kind of just the norm.
Right.
You
get so used to
that they would be in the Newcastle, like, life and being on that scene. You go out every night, like, you get pissed, you, like, right. chat shit to people, like... And that's just kind of the crack. But then, obviously, I suppose, as they grow older and, like, leave and stuff... Like, I know, like, some of the old cast members have left and been like, I'm never going back. And then they'll go back and I understand why, because it's like the money and like they'll sell you the dream and stuff.
Yeah.
But I mean, I guess what they would say behind the scenes would be very different. But the people who MTV are really good to, who like have their own shows, etc., not gonna name any names, but they will always be like, oh no, MTV are amazing with the aftercare, even though it's a blatant lie. Maybe they're amazing with you because you make them a lot of money.
Yeah, you're like the star of the show.
Not with everyone, wow. unfortunately. But I do want to reiterate, I love every single one of the cast members, actually.
Yeah, so I'm definitely getting that vibe, don't yeah. worry about it. It's just it's a crazy world, isn't
yeah
it?
They're just really nice people.
Yeah,
but they do, I feel like the vast majority, when they're actually out of their contracts and they're doing their own thing, like I think they will turn around and like speak their truth kind of thing.
Yeah, I think that would be so awesome and so empowering.
It would be really powerful, wouldn't
there.
It
yeah
I was
right?
actually going to make like a documentary on it earlier this year with this guy from Newcastle who like films stuff, but he's actually ended up getting a job with ITV, I think, as like a cameraman. He's like, I actually don't want to like jeopardize my future career. And I was like, yeah, I was thinking that when you started doing it, obviously if you want to be in this industry, this probably isn't the way to go. But we were actually like in the process of contacting people and setting up meetings, and we're gonna do this whole thing.
You could be the Stacey Dooley.
It could be the Stacey Dooley, couldn't I?
Maybe. Man, you would be so good at that.
Maybe I'll like do it on my own. But he was just really helping us out.
Well, you never know if there's any like directors or filmmakers in the Newcastle area listening. Like,
hit me up.
Because that would be so, I would fucking watch that in yeah. a heartbeat. And it would be so, so cool to see.
Because I was even, like at first, like a lot of people were like, I would love to do this, but I can't. But I was thinking, I could even do it like anonymous. Like,
yeah,
do you know what I mean?
Very
that
true.
Would probably be even cooler.
Yeah, exactly. It's people be like, who is that person?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Get the speculation and the hype going.
Man, put that out into the universe. That needs to fucking happen. Wow. Okay, we should probably actually ask some of the questions. Okay, so you know it. 70 questions, all ridiculous. And you are just going to pick a number between 1 and 70.
Mm-hmm. What, I do that right now?
You're gonna do that right now. Pick a number.
Okay, number 7, please.
Ooh, what made you go there?
7's like my lucky number.
Well, this isn't a fucking lucky number,
oh,
my friend.
Fuck.
It's my favorite question though. Out
okay.
of the whole 70.
Excellent.
What was the most traumatic part of your childhood?
Oh my god. So this is an interesting one for me because I feel like it's very evident that I seem to have daddy issues. However, growing up, my family were fairly functional. As we've got older, things started to twist. But I do always wonder where these daddy issues actually came from. However, like, I know that I had, like, friends, you know, when you're really little, like, when you're, like, 5, 6, and you grow up with people and you kind of just stuck with them because, like, they live in your street or, like, all this jazz. And I actually had a few friends growing up that were, like, I didn't realise I was older and I actually reflected on it, but they were, like, really horrible to us and, like, would always put us down and, like, wanted me to realise that, like, I'm not the cool one, they're the cool one. Do you know what I think? And, like, you know, when you look back and you're, like, God, I can't believe I let that person talk to me like that or, like, do that to me or, like... Yeah, so there was stuff like that when I was little, and I think that might have had an effect on why I have anxiety, because I think I always kind of thought, like, things would get taken away from me, or, like, people would, like, run away from me, or, like, do you know what I mean?
Right, yeah,
it does all
boil
down to stuff like that, so, like, but I will say I didn't have anything, like, hugely traumatic in my childhood, but, like, my family do have a history of, like, mental health problems.
Right.
And so there's been issues where my mum's struggled and she's tried to do, like, things to herself, and we've had to, like, bring that round. And then obviously, like, growing up, we're never really that family that are like, oh, like, I love you, do you know what I mean? And we obviously love each other, but we're just, it just wasn't our vibe. And I think that's okay, actually. But then, like, when that happened, we're like kind of try to force it on us, like, oh, I have to say, like, I love you every day. And I'm like, you can't just start saying that when we're, like, older, like, it's not natural to us.
Yeah,
it's like, even now, like, sometimes, like, they'll heavily be like, I love you, Sarah, and I'm like, fuck's sake, I love you too. But it's like, yeah,
man. A bit of a mad one. Do you think the depression and stuff, that, because it's genetic, right?
It
depression?
Is genetic, yeah.
And so your mum struggled with that,
yeah, and massively. So did I think my grandma did, and I think people on my dad's side did as well. Wow. My dad struggled badly with anxiety, he's been, like, hospitalized with it before and stuff, so. And my mom obviously has, like, the depression, so it was evident that I would have something, I think.
When did it start kind of creeping in for you?
I think the anxiety's probably always been there since being little. Oh,
bloody hell, we are right,
we are in Newcastle,
the
so but yeah, I think it's strange because, you know, when people say they're extroverted and introverted, that was very much me. Like, I was a very showy off child. Like, I loved to be centre of attention. Like, I had to be, like, really alternative. Like, the other girls would, like, dress up as, like, cats, and I'd be like, I literally say to my auntie, like, I want to be a granddad, like, draw wrinkles on my face, I'll wear, like, a fur coat. Just as such a little attention seeker. But at the same time, I was also, like, really quite nervous, I think. And so I think that just carried on. But I didn't realise it was anxiety until, like, teenage years. And then that's when I started having like, panic attacks and stuff.
Can you remember your first ever one?
Yeah, I can. My first panic attack was, I was drinking. Actually, no, that was panic attack number 2. My first panic attack was after Leeds Festival. And I'd obviously, like, had loads of alcohol. I'd just been doing loads of shit that I shouldn't have been doing. And, like, I feel like I was, like, losing the sensation in my hands. And I, like, dropped this hat, and I, like, couldn't recover how to, like, pick it back up. And I was like, oh my god, like, what is this feeling inside my soul? Like, I feel like I'm going to die. Like, but I didn't express it anyone, because I didn't want to alarm anyone, so I just kind of, like, dealt with it internally. And then there was another incident after that. I must have been about, like, 16, drinking again. I think drink is, like, a huge trigger
catalyst
for me.
Yeah.
I just always used to think, like, I can't get my breath, and I would hyperventilate. That's how it manifested when I was younger. And then as I got older, like, it's weird because it changes form. Like, sometimes it can be the hyperventilating, which is what I think it is for most people. But then it kind of started to be, like, I would get, like, a pain in my heart, which is obviously, it's just in your head. But, like, it really hurts. And, like, I'm, like, I'm having a heart attack, or, like, I always think I'm having a stroke. Because I'm a very stressy person, so I think it's, like, inevitable it'll happen to me kind of thing. But obviously it's just, like, catastrophizing,
yeah,
and it's just like your body scan, but it's obviously just the way that my mind works, unfortunately. And then I think, I don't know how no one picked up, including myself, on the fact that I had depression when I was a teenager, because, like, I was really sad. Like, I remember just being so sad about, like, the stupidest stuff, and I used to look at everyone, like, getting on with things and being so successful and being so proactive and productive, and I would be like, why is that not me? I don't understand why my mind doesn't work like that. But when we were little, like, there wasn't any resources on depression or mental health. The school never touched upon it, which is disgusting when you think back. If someone had talked about it in a lesson, it might have been like, oh, I'll go and see someone about that because that's how I feel. But it just, there was no internet really, like, you just wouldn't have known.
Yeah.
I think it's such a good thing now that it is so open, and like, people get pissed off and they're like, God, everyone talks about mental health now. Like, it's like people who don't even have it. And I'm like, I'd rather people who don't actually have it talk about it than no one ever talking about it. I'd rather people over talk about it. Do you know what I mean? Because I talk about it a lot and I feel like there must be some people like, God, she really pities herself. And I'm like, it's not that. It's that it's a huge part of my day-to-day life. It heavily affects us, whether I always display it or not. Like, I do often put on a front that, like, it's not happening. Like, I'm just like, God, Sarah's so happy, whatever. But if I don't talk about it or I don't share that little picture that's gonna, like, help someone, like, it's just not enough.
Yeah, because especially if you were that younger kid who felt really sad all the time.
Yeah.
Now there's Instagram and they might be following you and be like, oh, maybe that's what this is. But you didn't have that at that time to ever even wonder, could this be what that is?
Yeah.
How does, when did it kind of like peak for you then? When were you like, I actually need to find ways to cope now, like therapy or meditation and stuff?
So I first went to see a doctor. I think I must have been about 18, 19, because I wanted to kill myself, which obviously isn't a normal thing, but like, many people will have suicidal thoughts in their life. But I kind of like, I had a feeling, I was like, I don't think I would be able to go ahead with this, but I fantasize about it. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I would think like, I would love to just not wake up. Like, I wouldn't want to do it myself, but I would love it if that was to happen. And I was like, that's not normal.
Yeah.
And that's when I first went to see a doctor about it. And I think I went in and I got scared, so I pretended that I had like a fever or something, but I had like tears in my eyes, and like the guy just saw straight through it. He's like, do you want to talk? And I was like, yeah. And then referred us to therapy, but you know what it's like you don't hear from them for months. So they sent me a letter like maybe like 4 months later, and they were like, you can have your therapy appointment. And I was like, nah, I'm not going to that.
Wow.
I should have went.
Right.
But when you're feeling better, I think I was feeling a touch better just on that day even. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. It can be so kind of momentary.
And then I don't think I didn't return to therapy until I started having like proper panic disorder, which is where you have the fear of having a panic attack because you have them so often. So you're just trapped in a cycle of like
feedback loop.
Yeah. Like every day you're like, I'm going to have a panic attack. So like I'll constantly have to pull over the car or like just all sorts of stupid stuff. And that's when I started like seeing my first therapist, because obviously the like NHS are so slow with it. I had to pay, so I went to like a private lady, but luckily she works in my work building. Yeah, she's such a cool lady. And I was seeing her for a while, and then I was like, this is costing me a lot of money. But she actually cured me for a bit. So like I got cured, and I was like, I think she went on holiday for like 2 weeks, and then before that I was having a panic attack like every day. I was having them in the room while I was speaking to her about it.
Oh my God.
But then when she came back, like I was like I walked in the office, I don't think she expected it. I was like, something has clicked, like I haven't had a panic attack, like I feel absolutely sound. And she was like, well, I can't be taking money off you anymore, so like maybe like call me if you ever need me, but sounds like you're doing good. And then I was good for like a month, and then it just came back with a vengeance.
Fuck. Can you like pinpoint in any way why that would be, or why that month was so different? Was anything different for you?
Well, I started taking into account the things that she'd been telling us to do, and so like obviously like the meditation, like I think gratitude was a lot of it. Like I was just waking up and thinking like the sad stuff going on, like I have this condition which affects us, but I'm so lucky in other ways. And I just started to think more positively, and like I was like eating better, and just like, I don't know, something did just click. But then like I say, it's not linear, and if you have anxiety or depression, once you recover, I think there's like a 1 in 3 chance that you'll relapse, and then by the second relapse that doubles. So obviously I've had many relapses, so like it's never gonna fully go, and I've just kind of accepted that you just have to like ride the waves of when it's good and when it's bad. So then I went back, and it took us to physically be on the crisis team, like line, being like, I like really want to harm myself, like I'm really really struggling, like I want to either like admit myself to like a ward, or like I need help now kind of thing. And that's when they like sped up the process that I could see someone. And then I was seeing someone, and I find this so strange. So like, I can't fault her because she taught us techniques that have really helped us, and like, once again, I got cured from that, but like, it came back, etc. But I found it really strange because my first lady, who was private, she was like a therapist but also a counselor, so she knew everything about me. But this lady didn't know a single thing about me apart from my name, and because it's that sort of therapy, they don't actually ask you anything about your past, etc. And I just found it so strange. I was like, how are you supposed to treat me if you don't know like me struggle?
Yeah, like, we're entirely made up of our past.
Yeah,
that's who we are. We're like the sum total.
That's why I have
of
these problems.
Yeah,
and so I found that so strange. But then my other therapist lady, whose lashes I do, who I always talk about, she said it's because it's like, it's two different types of training. So if you train to do that, you're not trained in the counseling.
Okay.
And it would be too expensive to train everyone in like both aspects, which I kind of understand. But I think
it's so important though. It's such a, like, it's vital. It yeah. feels like.
But I think they do it back to front, because after that therapy, like, I had my sessions and she was like, do you want further therapy? And I was like, I'm feeling really good, but I do, because I know how long it took me to get here and I don't want to waste the resources. She was like, well, I can refer you on to counseling. But I think that counseling should be stage one.
Yeah.
And then the other stuff should be stage two, really.
That makes so much more sense.
I think so. Even if you just have one session of half an hour at the start and be like, this is what happened, like, growing up, this is like,
like, this
who
is
I
the
am.
Foundation of me.
Yeah.
And we can work on the rest. That makes so much sense.
Definitely.
So where are you in the wave now?
I've had a really good, like, 3 weeks. Like, I've had, like, the odd moment. I still have anxiety all the time, and I still think these stupid irrational thoughts in my head where I'm like, I'm having a panic attack, I'm having a stroke, but I know somewhere deep inside that I'm not, and I'm able to like tame the symptoms before it becomes like hyperventilating, like pins and needles, like pass out, whatever. So I feel really good, and I am, this is controversial, but I actually stopped taking my medication like a week ago. I've took one tonight because I was like, just in case, do you know what I mean, like going out and about. But I'm gonna try and like wean myself off it, but obviously I'm not promoting that to anyone because you need to speak to your GP and stuff. But mine is only a beta blocker, and so I was just reducing the dosage anyway, and then I was like, right, I'm only taking like half a pill a day, so I can probably do this without. And then that's the whole thing of anxiety: if you believe you can do it, then you can do it. Do you know what
yeah,
I mean?
Totally.
So I'm feeling very good, feeling very positive. But
and it must feel nice to take control over
yeah.
your own like body and self, and be like, I am going to not do this, and I'm going to do more of this, and I'm going to see, like, because I guess all you can do is experiment really and test,
yeah,
see what works for you. And then in a couple of weeks, I guess, if it doesn't, you're like, okay, I'll go back to this and yeah, like do a half of it or whatever it is.
Yeah,
man, it's a hell of a lot though, isn't it? Like, I when I hear people talk about anxiety and panic disorders and stuff, I just feel for them so much because
yeah.
I can't relate. Mm-hmm. And I'm like really glad I can't relate
yeah.
because it just sounds terrifying. Like, you're just on the edge all the time.
It's like literally the worst thing in the world. And I think the saddest thing is that, like, because I have this like irrational thought process, like sometimes I make like bargains in my head. And like, I remember in the height of it, how bad it was, like I would think in my head, like, right, whoever's listening, like, it's not God because I don't believe in God, but whoever is like hearing my thoughts, like, if you can give us, I'll take double the depression, like I'll be double sad if you can take that part away.
Wow.
Because it's literally like
debilitating.
The person, like, imagine your own self not being able to look after yourself and your own mind going against you. Like, it's the worst thing in the world. It's like having someone horrendous inside your brain, but it's you. It's fucking awful. Like, there's literally, I've never faced a worse battle in my entire life than having like proper bad anxiety and panic disorder. And I feel like it is so hard for people to understand who don't have it, because I think there's a lot of like people that I go around with who didn't know me, maybe they knew me like a year ago when it wasn't so bad, and they haven't seen the height of it, like only really really close friends and like my family have seen is when I've been like literally like scream crying on the floor being like, I need help or I'm gonna like do something stupid. And I think it's like people just think, oh, anxiety, they're nervous. And I'm like, that's not true. I'm a really confident person. But I have these irrational phobias of illness, or like that something bad's going to happen or something's going to be taken away from me, just because they've been like themes within my life. And
right.
It's so sad. It's awful. But like I say, like with the mindfulness and training my mind not to think that way, and like just going with the thoughts, like say I have a thought in my head that's like something awful is going to happen to you, like when you walk in this bar, like you're gonna have a heart attack, then the other part of my brain I'll be like, that's a complete like catastrophization of what's actually going to happen. You're going to walk in the bar, you're going to get a drink, and you're going to enjoy your night just like everyone else. Like, you kind of just have to like hug those thoughts with like the other part and be like, you have to use the rational side more. And I think that's a problem. People with anxiety are people who are really super sensitive and they're empaths, and that's me, because I think too emotionally. And when you use that part of your brain too much, it overtakes and you can't use the logic side. I think, I mean, I'm no expert. This is just what I've concluded.
No, but like, if you're going through it and have been going through it for so long, then you are pretty much an expert in that field for you. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I can imagine mindfulness being so helpful. Did it take you like a while to grasp that? Because I know even for me, even just the thought of realizing that you're not your thoughts, mm-hmm. and that just because you have one doesn't mean you have to follow it down that track. And,
yeah.
But that's like that's hard to grasp, I think, to realize you're not the person in your brain and that you can kind of control it. Like, did that take time for you to practice?
Yeah, and I think I still have to work on it. Like, it's so strange because, like, I'm literally a different person now to who I've been in the past. Like, in the past, like, I haven't even been the best person. Like, I used to make really bad decisions. Like, sometimes I would take, like, my anger out on other people. Like, I was really destructive. Like, I used to love arguing with people and, like, I don't know. When I look back at that person, like, no one ever stopped us and was like, the way that your thought process isn't right.
Right.
Like,
do you think you would have been able to hear that though, had someone being like, your thought process? Or, because it would be so hard to even understand at that point, like, what the fuck, you don't know my brain? Like, yeah. It just must be so hard. I really feel for you.
Yeah. But I think I was forced to recognize it when I started having like all the mental health problems and stuff. And I was just like, I can't go on every day in this negative mindset. Like, you've just got to, like, I think the thing with anxiety, right, is you stress about the past and you stress about the future, but that is literally the most pointless, counterproductive emotion you can ever have in your life. Like, life is what's happening to you at the present.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like, you literally just have to wake up. Like, maybe I had a bad day yesterday, but I woke up today and I'm like, I'm going to have a good day today. Like, yesterday's gone. Like, it's literally gone. Like, you can sit and stew over things that have happened to you in the past and you can replay them in your head over and over again. It does nothing. So, like, I try and put my brain into like productive stuff, and I think that's why I like threw myself into my work. Like, I work a lot of hours and like I spend a lot of time like researching how I can be better within my job and like just like networking and stuff like that. And I think just having an outlet to do something is like so amazing. And you'll know yourself, obviously, with that's your music for you. I think once people find like kind of like their passion and what gives them a little bit of fire, if you can like channel all that energy that you have in like dwelling on other stuff and sad stuff, just put it into that if you can. Like, it's easier said than done. It comes with practice. It's like meditation. Like, I'm a pro at it now because I've done it for so long, but like when I started, like, I didn't really know what I was doing. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's just the same as anything. It's a skill you have to practice and you have to train yourself, and you gotta be patient and forgiving with yourself as well. Like, I forgive myself for a lot of stuff. Like, there's a lot of stuff that I've done in the past where I'm like, I shouldn't have done that. I'm not gonna beat myself up over it every single day.
Man, you're amazing. I like, there's so much strength to you and what you're saying. Like, to go through what you've gone through anyway, like the kind of the physical stuff of actually just going through Geordie Shore, whatever,
mm-hmm.
but then to have the kind of panic disorders, the side order of depression, the kind of irrational thoughts, like, you know, wanting to die and stuff, and to come out of that and be like, no, I choose gratitude every day, and mm-hmm. like, that stuff's so powerful, and it's so hard for people to get there. I feel like,
yeah.
And the fact that you're like, yeah, you know, I can be forgiving to myself, like, to go from that to that,
yeah,
is huge. Like, and that takes so much work. So I feel like you're amazing. That takes such work, and you've put in that work, and that's just so fucking cool.
That is so nice to hear. Thank you.
Honestly though, it's because it's,
I feel like I was kind of forced into it though, because it's like what they say, like, when you hit rock bottom, there's nowhere to go lower. Like, literally, I had to do it. If I didn't do it, I would have done something stupid. So yeah, I'm so glad that I did do that.
Yeah. Because it's weird. When Mum died, I actually put that on one of my videos the other day. I wouldn't count myself as suicidal, because I was terrified of actually doing it.
Yeah.
The thought of it was just like, oh no, I couldn't actually do it. but I would think about it all day, every day. And I know categorically, had I been given a way out, I would have done it in a heartbeat. Oh my God,
yes, that's what I always think. Like, in those times, if someone, like, I wouldn't have physically been able to do it myself because I'm, like, so scared of pain. Like, I have anxiety, for God's sake. I'm not going to, like, stick my head in the oven. Do you know what I mean? But if someone was to give me two pills and be like, right, you can take this one, and, like, you just won't wake up, you won't feel anything. Like, I would have done it as well.
Same.
So I don't know what that's called, because it is being suicidal, but it's obviously not acting on it. Do you know what I mean? But, like, if you fantasize about it, I think, like, you need to, like, take action on that. Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
But, like, thank God we were never given that way out.
No, yeah.
It's so true what they say, that just wait a couple more days. Like, things can change so quickly. Like, energy moves so quickly. And I actually, after this last breakup, and a couple days after it, I was... Do you know what? Genuinely, it was worse than losing mum.
Yeah.
And that sounds so fucked up, but my mum always said it, like, when someone dies, they don't choose to leave you, but when someone breaks up with you, they are choosing to leave you. And that rejection feels almost worse. And I text my dad, who's like GP/holistic doctor now, and I said to him, like, it's really sad, but I text him saying, if I still feel this sad in a year, can you please just help me die?
Yeah.
Just thinking, like, you know, he will have the ways to help me do it kind of ethically. But I mean, of course, my fucking dad's not going to be like, yeah, no worries. Yeah, but
that's because obviously, like, you're in such a traumatic time, the emotional side of your brain has taken over, and you would have genuinely thought in that moment, like, this is what I want so much, my dad will do it. Obviously, he's not going to do that, but you're not in your rational headspace at that time. But it, like, must have been so, like, shocked to get that message, bless him.
I know, and it must have been very, like, sad for him to hear too. It's not something I would ever message, obviously.
Yeah.
But I remember, like, it's crazy the depths of where your mind can go, because, you know, like, when you're describing your moments in Geordie Shore, I feel like on the video, and you were kind of scratching yourself, whatever. I was like, it was the most amount of emotional pain I have ever felt. And I was scratching my legs and just going absolutely fucking insane.
Mm-hmm.
But literally 2 days later, I was so fine again. Like, you know, it still hurt, but, like, I was nowhere near that depth. But it terrifies me just knowing that that depth exists.
Yeah.
I know how sad I can get now.
Mm-hmm.
And I am terrified. I never want to be in that position again. And I'm so... And I think, like you said, when you get to those real, real lows, there really is only the way up. And you...
Exactly.
You can't go anywhere else because you're... And probably because you are so terrified of ever getting that low again. You're like, right, I'm going to put stuff in place to make sure I never get that low again. So whether it be, like, meditating or gratitude and stuff, those things are just so important. And I've realized that even in the past year... Like, setting intentions, and it's all the kind of spiritual crap, but actually is just so helpful.
Yeah.
Gratitude, just getting outside of the house, going for a walk. And it's all stuff that I really can't be asked to do. But I know categorically, if I did it Monday to Friday, I am going to fucking feel on top of the world.
I think it is so important. I'm reading a book at the minute, and it's about, like, how... Well, it's not all about this, it's just the current bit I'm reading. It's about how imperative your morning routine is to the rest of your day. Which I agree with. Like, it explained it in the way of, like, give an example of a lady that woke up and, like, all these things happened to her. And then listed next to it was written, like, MSD. So that means, like, a micro stress something. Okay. So if you think about it, if you wake up and the first thing you do, your alarm goes off, it's a blare and horrible noise. And then you scroll Instagram and you see, like, a sad story or, like, something that's upset you. And then that's, like, that's three micro stresses already you've even moved from your bed. And so he recommends that you, like, wake up, don't look at your phone. Like, the first thing to do would be just do, like, a quick 5-minute meditation. Like, I'm grateful for the day, whatever. And then I think the second one is movement. So, like, I'll, like, make, like, my coffee or whatever, decaf, anxiety goals. And then, like, just do like literally like some stretches. Like I just like creak my neck and like do this with my arms and like just stretch myself out a bit, because it's so true. Like if I go to work and I haven't done that, I'm obviously gonna be hunched over and like all uncomfortable. And then so it's mindfulness, movement, oh, and meditation, which I've already done. So
okay, right.
Then like in the mindfulness, you could just set like 3 goals for the day, and they don't even have to be big. Like
it can be like just go, make sure you go outside, yeah, once, or like read a page of a book or something.
And once you've like achieved those goals, like you feel like your day's been so much more productive than if you hadn't done that. And like it's wild, like I've been doing it for a couple of weeks and like I feel like I have such a better day when it started off on like a high note.
That's amazing. I really, really, because I have had weeks where I've had things in place. Like I definitely make sure that every single time I shower, I say out loud all the things I'm grateful for. That's in my routine now. But like I was saying before, meditation is one of those things I know I have to do it, but almost because it's there and something I suddenly now have to do, I don't want to do it, which is ridiculous. But again, like you said, once you put something in and do it for like a week, you really fucking see the difference in your like mental well-being. Exercise is my thing.
Yeah.
Like, do you like exercise? Is that a part of... No, me neither.
I do not like exercise in any way, shape or form.
How are you with like body image and stuff?
It's a strange one because I've always been one of those really annoying people, like until like maybe this year where I was like, I can eat what I want and I can do what I want. And I was never like in shape, but I was always small. Do you know what I mean? So I was okay. Like I've never felt like, oh, I'll go on holiday, I'll not wear a bikini. But then this year has been the first year where I'm like, yeah, I probably wouldn't be comfortable. Like I'll have to do something. Like I've actually like went up a dress size for like the first time in my life. So I think, I don't know if it's like, I've pinned it down to my medication, but when you Google it, it's mixed reviews. Like they don't say that weight gain is a side effect of what I take.
Okay.
But then other people have like commented on the forum being like, yeah, I've literally like expanded. And I'm like, yeah, I don't understand. Like I feel like I'm eating better than ever, but I'm getting bigger. So that's like part of the reason why I've stopped taking it, because I'm like, why is it affecting my body?
Okay, yeah, to kind of test that out as well
in that way. But then I feel like my job is fairly active, like when you do makeovers and stuff, like you're all up and down. And then obviously, like you say, like I started doing dance class, which I do more, I think, for my mind. It's just nice to be, it's all my friends from school, because it's my school friend that runs it, who like I managed to get disconnected from because we just all led such busy lives. It's just so nice to be around like nice, genuine people, just like doing something that's not serious. Do you know what I mean? But I suppose that's a touch of exercise, but
definitely
I'm trying to do it more. Like I've been doing like mini little workouts and shit, but like you say, I'm not one of them people that's like, god, I'm so pumped, like I really enjoyed that, like fuck that, like I do it because I like want to be littler. So.
I know, I make no bones about that. I'm like, I envy the people that are that just like to do exercise because they're like, I want to feel fit and healthy. I'm like, no, I want to lose weight. That will be the only fucking reason I exercise. Yeah. I can assure you. But it's not good enough because it's not keeping me doing it ever. I always like stop. I've been on this cycle fucking since I was probably 13. It's so sad. I look back at, you know, Facebook has the On This Day thing.
Yeah.
And just all of them from like 10 years ago are me talking about a diet that I'm going on and I need to lose weight, blah, blah, blah. Fucking look at me when I'm 18. I am a stick.
Yeah.
Now I'm up 3 dress sizes. Uh-huh. And I'm like, Kate, 18-year-old Kate, you had fucking no idea how good you had it.
Oh my God.
But I was stressing about losing weight even then.
But it's a decade later. Like, we're women now. Do you know what I mean? Like,
fucking women.
It's also part of it that just thinks, like, God, like, who cares? Like, when I actually think about it, like, what I am attracted to, etc. I don't like muscle men, or like I like men who are like either like they're not athletic. Do you know what I mean? Like I couldn't care if they took off the top and like they had like a roll or like whatever. I'll be like, yes, cute. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I wouldn't give a shit.
If
either.
You don't have that mindset, then I probably don't want to be associated with you anyway. I think the priority should always be your head over your physical body.
That's so
that's
true.
Controversial topic, but. I think it is.
Like, that's so true.
I wouldn't be happy if I was getting up at 6 a.m. and doing like an insanity workout. I'd be like, I'd look lush, but I don't know. I think it would probably like destroy us. So I think that's the point. You have to like learn the balance. Like if you're saying like you don't fully enjoy it, but like you like to go on a walk and get outside, maybe try and make that your exercise.
Yeah,
of the day.
I think so. Because I know obviously from doing these kind of little bouts of exercising and dieting, I know that when I exercise, I feel amazing. It's so strange. Like, you know that A gets you to B. Mm-hmm. And you know that happiness is over there when you just do some exercise. And yet you're like, no, don't want to do it. It's like, why? It's going to make you feel better.
Yeah.
It's something I've never got down. And my goal was to try and figure all this shit out before I'm 30. But that is not going to happen. But I think I'd like, that would be the thing that would maybe keep me going, is just do it for the head. Like, yeah. You know you're going to feel good after it. You want to feel good every day. Yeah, even like you said, it doesn't have to be a fucking insanity workout. Just go for a walk, because you know that's going to make you feel good. And it's some amount of exercise, even if it's not vigorous.
Exactly.
Oh, fucking exercise. I hate it. Right. Let's pick another number. I feel like we've got so much conversation.
Haven't I only picked one number?
Yeah, literally one number.
Jeez. I pick 28.
28. Okay. Oh, when have you caused the most harm to yourself?
Shit.
Physically or emotionally?
That is deep, isn't it?
We don't mess around.
Probably after my most recent breakup, I think, unfortunately. Like, in the midst of, like, when it happened. I don't think I've ever felt sadness that so sad. Like, I was just, like, used to, like, my time to cry would be, like, in the car on the way to work and then on the way home from work. Because, like, when I was at work, I just want to make everyone happy. Do you know what I mean? I just want to, like, yeah. So I just remember just being like so sad and just being like so destructive as well, like just doing stuff that wasn't gonna help, like going out and like getting drunk and doing all this horrible stuff and just like ruminating. Like, it's a big anxiety thing, obviously. Like, I would just go over situations in my head and be like, why has this happened? Like, why has this person done this? Like,
yeah, like you're your own worst enemy in those moments.
And I feel like I nearly lost the plot again. Like, I was thinking in my head, like, I'm going to have to give up everything that I've worked so hard for, which is, like, my business and stuff. Because I was thinking, I don't know if I'm, like, strong enough to, like, just function every day. Do you know what I mean? But obviously, like, I fought through it. But is that the time when I've done the most harm to myself? I just think my thoughts were very damaging. And I was, like, beating myself up over stuff, which I shouldn't have been doing.
Yeah, because I remember talking to my mum about this once, because she's a counsellor and then went through her phase of being a monk on a mountain and shit. So she was always the best with this advice. But I remember saying to her, because you understand mindfulness, you get to a point where you can watch your thoughts, you know where they're going.
Yeah.
But at so many points in my life, I know exactly what I'm doing. I know what my brain's doing and I do not stop it.
Yeah.
And she put it so eloquently. She was like, you're letting your ego go on a spending spree of devastation.
Oh my God.
I was like, that's such a cool way of putting at it. But it's so true. Like, I'm like, yeah, fucking brain, go nuts. Like, make me feel horrendous. And I'll just go into it for like an hour. Even though I'm watching myself do it, I feel like, yeah, emotionally, it's so... I think people do harm to themselves every single day in that way.
Yeah, that's true, actually, because I feel like the whole mindfulness thing is like trying to train your soul as opposed to your ego. They're like polar opposites. But like you say, like, when you want to get in that sadness mode, like, you would stick on like a sad film or like listen to sad music and like, this is harming me, but like, I'm still do it because it feels good. But like, you come to learn that, like, actually I'm actually gonna do stuff that like uplifts me.
Yeah,
do you know what I mean? But it's so easy
balance
done.
Though, isn't there? I don't think, I've learned this very recently, I don't think it's good to avoid pain.
Yeah.
Like, this book, The Untethered Soul, have you ever read it?
I haven't.
Fuck me. Like, it's absolutely insane. but it talks about pain, emotional pain, as being like a thorn in your body.
Right.
And for example, actually, I won't go into the real example because there's people involved, but whatever it is, there's something you're trying to avoid hearing about or whatever, and so you build like a little fort around your arm, and then it just gets bigger and bigger. You're terrified people are gonna brush into you, and it just affects every single interaction you have. And then you, like, it kind of builds up this picture, and it's like, rather than spending your entire life trying to protect this thing, just go into it, take it out, like face it head on,
yeah,
lean into the pain. And having done that, I mean, I spent a couple months like trying to avoid hearing about like my ex, or mm-hmm. avoid seeing people that had seen him and blah, blah, blah. And it was just messing with my head. It was messing with my friends' heads. And I was like, this isn't good. Like, and I was talking to my dad and he was saying like, there's no point avoiding that. Like,
yeah,
go into it. And so I was like, you know what? I'm going to make that a conscious decision. So I was like, I met up with these friends and I was like, I'm sorry, I've kind of been trying to avoid you and avoid hearing about it. But actually, yeah, that's what's going to make me grow. That's so mm-hmm. it's a weird balance to where to draw the line with pain. Where is it too much? Let your like stop letting your brain go that far. And yeah, then where is it actually I need to face that?
I agree. I think you definitely have to feel it. You have to feel it like in depth, and you have to be sad about stuff. But there has to be a point where you can't let it consume you. But I know what you mean, because I feel like maybe I'm not the best at it, because I'm more of like an avoidance. Whereas like I did the same, like I isolated myself from like so many of my friends, became distant from everyone because I didn't want to hear anything about a certain situation. I didn't want to go anywhere where I might see someone. And like, obviously with that person being like it person, like in the Newcastle scene, like he's just everywhere, so a lot of my friends would want to go where he would be, and I would just be like, well, there's no point in us going because it's going to be a sad night for me. So like I became like very withdrawn. But like my therapist was like, no, do you know what, you need to actually attend, because you're catastrophizing everything, like just go in, it'll be fine, do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But then like someone else said to me like, no, I don't agree with that, like if you know it's gonna upset you, then just don't put yourself in that situation. I think it's very subjective. I think there's times when you could apply it, and there's times when you're like, yeah, I'm gonna take myself out of that situation because if it makes me super uncomfortable, I'm not gonna do it. But then I should also be training my head to be like, you can't do that though.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? But you definitely have to feel the pain, because I know so many people who like aren't facing their problems, and I'm like, if you don't, they will resurface. They'll mm-hmm. resurface 10 years later.
Yeah.
And it'll be even worse, and they'll manifest in all your relationships, etc., going forward.
Yeah.
So it's just finding the balance, yeah, I think.
Because I asked my dad that as well when it came to this situation. I was like, I don't know where to draw the line, what feels too much. And he was like, you will know what feels too much when it suddenly becomes overwhelming and you actually physically cannot deal with it. That's when you know, take yourself out of it. That's not a good... But... Yeah, he kind of put it down to like a gut feeling. You kind of know what's a good pain to just,
yeah,
the ripping the plaster off type thing. And now having done it, I'm like, I'm so glad I did that. Because like, yeah, you said, you are catastrophizing all the time. Like I made it so much fucking worse in my head than it really was in real life. And I feel like that could be said for quite literally every every part of my life. Mm-hmm. Isn't it always worse in your head?
Yeah.
Always.
And I was actually listening to a podcast recently about something similar, whereby there's two different types of pain. So there's like dirty pain and there's clean pain, and clean pain is where you feel the pain and you know it's legit because it's something that would happen, whereas dirty pain would be like, oh, does this person not like me anymore because they've been slightly off with me? Like clean pain would be like, this person's expressed to me they don't like me, so I'm gonna hurt about it. But the dirty pain is like so counterproductive, you can't pass out about this stuff, like it will just eat you alive.
Yeah.
You just gotta think, like it's so many times, like be present in the moment and just be like, what will be, like you, I spend so long trying to like stop situations happening, like preventing them by like doing just stupid stuff, and then I was just like, yeah, but those things, if they do happen, they're meant to happen, like you've just gotta let it, it's gotta let it crack on, do you, yeah, know what I mean? But it's a hard pill to swallow.
It is, but it's also, once you swallow that pill, kind of like an ecstasy pill, once, yeah, you get over the hurdle and you're like, it's actually so liberating when you realize how little control you have, which, yeah, is weird because as human beings, all we want to do is control the outcome.
Yeah.
But the fact is, we like, whatever the fuck is going to happen is going to happen.
Yeah.
Like, you may as well just go along with the ride. And I listened to this podcast episode, I think it was Jay Shetty,
mm-hmm,
interviewing Mike Posner, you know, that I took a pill, weirdly just talking about an ecstasy pill. But
the universe.
I know, right? He was talking to some kind of like meditation guru, and he just put it really simply. He was like, it's much easier to just love everything.
Yeah.
And it's not like it's impossible in our like human brains, but it's to resist what is just stupid. It's a waste of an energy and emotion in you. Like today, like the stupid example, me being hungover and being like, oh, this fucking sucks. I just wish blah, blah, blah. And it's like, well, it isn't. So you may as well just get the fuck on board with it and be like, okay, this feels a bit crap, but it is what it is. I'm trying to think of a better fucking thing than a hangover. But now, since this book, The Untethered Soul, which I will never stop going on about, link in description if you want to buy it. Full disclosure, it's from my Amazon shop, so I'll be getting a cut. But yeah, what was it saying? Oh, kind of about emotional pain, like when you just see it as an energy, and that's literally it. So like, there's nothing to ever be scared of, because you, once you become present, you start realizing, oh, okay, yeah, I'm feeling really sad. My heart's like beating really fast. I can feel it, and I'm noticing it. And then to just notice it, you don't have to run with it and let your brain go catastrophizing. You can just be like, okay, yeah, this feels crap. It's cool. I'm just going to ride it out. Like, I'm going to welcome it.
Yeah. So don't
let
like,
it feel what it does, you know?
Don't like feel it and then beat yourself up over it. Like, don't be like, oh, why am I feeling this? Like, you feel it and you'll be like, I feel like this. And then you just let it wash over and you just forgive yourself. Like, so what? Like, this human.
Yeah. Being kind to yourself is so important, isn't it?
Oh, God, yeah. It's like the main thing, I feel.
Yeah. I'm constantly trying to encourage, because it's such a normal human thing for us to do, especially like, I know, for example, we know what's going to make us feel good and we don't do it. And so it's so easy to be like, well, of course I'm going to fucking beat myself up. I didn't do the thing that I knew my brain was good. But the fact is, like, that is just human nature.
Yeah.
We're pretty crap sometimes and we fail a lot all of the time. But like, I always, always say to my friends, if ever they're in that kind of situation, what would you say to me if I was in that? And it's a completely different ball game. They're like, oh, well, I'd say, chill out. Don't worry about it. Don't beat yourself up. And I'm like, well, say that to yourself.
Yeah.
It's hard though, isn't it?
It's so hard. Like, there's so many situations I've been in where I look back and I'm like, God, if I was on the outside in, like, I would tell my friend, like, not to do that or to feel differently about it. And I think it's a very wise thing to start doing that to yourself. And I think it comes with maturity. Like, 10 years ago, like, I wouldn't. Like, you say, I would just revel in, like, the sadness and just feel it, whatever. But now I'm like, God, I literally don't have time for this. Like, I ain't got the time. Like, I've got to have a good day today. So I'm just going to be grateful for, like, all the things around me. And I think I also removed the bad things from my life. Like, when you actually start removing the toxicity, it's amazing how much better your life becomes. Like, I don't surround myself with, like, I used to be around a lot of yes people and a lot of people who I think were in my company because I was a party girl and they just wanted to stay up all night, or they wanted to get in the cool club, or like they wanted to like do whatever. So I was just surrounded by all these people who would have backstabbed me in 0.4 seconds, do you know what I mean? And many of them did. So I was just like, do these people actually make me feel good about myself? No, who makes me feel good about myself is the people I grew up with, people who like are physically caring, amazing people who don't care about like social status and all that stuff. And I guess it's just when I was kind of trying to chase the fame game and think that the grass was greener, but like when I've sat back and matured and realized, God, I feel so, so much happier away from anything like that.
Wow, that's so cool. Yeah. What did Justin Bieber say? Grass ain't always greener on the other side. It's green where you water it.
Facts from Biebs.
Isn't that true?
I really thought you were going to sing that there and I got really excited.
Imagine. Just full on sing the whole song. That's where I'm going to end it today, guys. Don't forget, you can get the last 15 minutes of that episode exclusively on patreon.com/KateMcGill for as little as $1 a month. I hope you loved my chat with Sarah. I absolutely love her and it was such a pleasure to talk to her. Like I said, one of my favorite conversations so far. Don't forget to follow us on social media if you haven't already at We Dive Deeper. Join in the conversation. Let me know what you think of the episodes. Let me know if I could do something better, if you want more of something or you want us to discuss a specific topic. Let me know because I love hearing what you guys think. And it's just so cool to build a community of people that enjoy becoming self-aware and enjoy self-development. I think it's an awesome thing to do, and I'm glad that I've got people that enjoy it as much as I do. So with that being said, go forth, go enjoy your life, go figure out more about yourself, and I will see you back here in a couple of weeks for episode 2.